to warmly welcome you all to the symposium on Indo-Sri Lanka Joint Research Program on behalf of the Ministry of Science, Technology and Research. This is the symposium first program organized by my ministry to give the floor to both country researchers, those who did a joint research under Indo-Sri Lanka Science and Technology Collaboration, to share their experience and outcome to the scientific community. We understand that the research and innovation play a significant role in contributing to national development goals, especially for creating knowledge-based economy, and potential benefits of research and development linkages with appropriate stakeholders show a pathway for building an innovation and entrepreneurship ecosystem. In turn, this ecosystem supports to provide high-value products and services to compete with global markets. Further, I wish to point out sharing of experiences and best practices of science and technology among nations would lead to achieve sustainable development goals for entire globe. This could be reached through bilateral and multilateral cooperations on science and technology. Considering the fact Sri Lanka too have a bilateral and multilateral cooperations on science and technology, and our ministry was entered into a program of cooperation with the Department of Science and Technology India in 2011, where one of the modes of cooperation is joint research programs and workshops. With the engagement of scientists of both countries, 8 research projects related to the fields on food, health and nutrition, geology and sea level rise were initiated in the year 2013 and successfully completed this year. So I wish to congratulate all of the researchers engaged in the joint research program. Besides, I am confident this symposium is to showcase the research findings among researchers and other relevant stakeholders so as to enhance the knowledge base as well as to stakeholders' future collaboration. As joint research program is a continuous one, we have initiated the second phase of joint research program this year as well. So we already called express of interest, and we are in the process of selecting the joint collaborative projects. In this point, I wish to invite researchers and evaluators to give due consideration for emerging technology related research proposals that should be mutually benefited for both countries. I take this opportunity to thank the Department of Science and Technology of India and Government of India to provide support in the fields of science and technology to Sri Lanka. Finally, I again reiterate, this symposium would create a platform for us to reorient our research priorities in the light of regional economic development and joint research program for enhanced collaboration between the two countries. And I look forward for future collaboration as well in this field. With this, I concluded my remarks, and I again warmly welcome, and I must thank the Honorable Minister and the Excellency, the Ambassador of India, to come and grace this occasion and encourage the researchers and research findings to and with other stakeholders as well. And I also wish this symposium a second success. Thank you.
I wish to speak to you on international collaboration, enhancing research capacity in developing countries. Before I begin, I wish to thank the organizing committee for having given me the opportunity to give you my views on this matter. Now, research in the past did not have much collaboration. In the past, at the very beginning, when the Industrial Revolution began, they were in two stages. And if you look at the history of how science began at that time, most of the researchers were individuals, some of them with no scientific education at all, most of them had were aiming at trying to produce some industrial product which they could capitalize on. If you take a person like Benjamin Franklin in the US, he gave up schooling at year 10, at age 10, and then became a worked in his father's shop making candles, finally became a printer's apprentice. But he ended up giving us several products. He saw discovery of electricity. The bifocal lens you are wearing was originated by him. And he all this came up because through self-learning. And he has done various things. He was a statesman, politician, member. He was also a diplomat. And all this he did by himself. But the main operations in the old days, first industrial revolution in the late 18th century, was trying to improve technology in textiles. So there was engineering, there are technology, and entrepreneurship. And it's believed that this was promoted by England having the best laws on patents. The people who could come up with a product could patent it easily without much restrictions and try to and get hold of some businessman and make some money out of it. So there are a lot of improvements in getting coal from the ground, cast iron, gas lighting. Before the possibility of lighting with gas was found, they used to use candles at factories, and this was not possible. You can't work very late in the day. But once gas came in, it was possible to extend hours of work. Before that, a lot of people, because of the lack of facilities, had to work in the houses and give the product to the factory. Steam power made things life much easier. Then with good steel, which we got from the coal, they were able, they were able to make machine tools. Also, agricultural machines started coming to scene. Chemistry, there were acids, alkalis, dyes, all this came in the first industrial revolution. In the second industrial revolution, the late 19th century, the first one was used to rapidly industrialize with the expansion of technology in all the cities in England. Railroad and road expansion meant that goods could be transported very easily. Steamers mean they could come to our countries as well. But there was more research in the second part. There was the ideas of thermodynamics, the Carnot cycle, all this came about the second industrial revolution and led to efficiency in the processes. Petroleum, the distillation of petroleum became possible because of research carried out at this stage. Fertilizer, they were able to find out methods of making fertilizer much more efficiently because earlier they had to get a rare element to get the phosphorus part, rare material. Dyes, William Perkins, electricity, telegraph, the phone, all this came up at this time. But all this research was done by individual scientists, not by big groups. No, there was no collaboration. Usually a scientist who often was self-learned had some collaboration with an entrepreneur, not with anybody else. Someone who was prepared to take his product to the market.
So the magic of nature has also kept our two nations in close proximity. And this makes most of our challenges common, and so is our approach. The effort is always here to gain experience from each other through collaborations. Science technology pursuit is known to be a remarkably effective catalyst for societal development and economic growth, as it empowers not only the individual but the society and country at large. So here most of the things are said by the international collaboration and India's strength. So I'm now touching a different perspective of India, that is science and technology for society. Science, technology, and innovation can exist separately on their own in disconnected spaces, but it is their integration that leads to a new value creation. Science, technology, and innovation for the people is a new paradigm of the Indian science technology system. Any country's global competitiveness will be determined by the extent to which science technology enterprise contributes to the social good or the economic wealth. The national science technology and innovation system must therefore recognize the society and the citizen as its major stakeholder. It is somewhat similar to the concept of citizen science in Sri Lanka.
It not only encourages scientists to develop scientific problems based on the scientific societal issues or the common challenges which are faced by the society. It also allows all citizens of the country to become the scientist. Promoting the same, this year on Republic Day, our Prime Minister has given one of the prestigious Padma Shri Award in Science and Engineering to a handloom weaver called Chintikandi Malesham. He has innovated a machine called Asu machine, which processes yarn mechanically. He invented this machine to make life easier for his mother. He has seen his mother working hard for hours to wind meters of silk yarn on a large frame. The process of winding is called Ashu and used to make famous Pochampalli sarees in one of the state, Telangana. Now this machine has made life easier of thousands of weavers of that area. So by promoting, like by giving that award, he has promoted that kind of innovation, which has affected the life of society. It is one of the steps of Government of India towards promoting innovations addressing societal challenges. This narration is also a response to those who complained lack of appropriate infrastructure for pursuing quality research. I do not dilute the importance of high precision quality science or basic science, but I want to stress on science for society, science to help our brotherhood improve economic conditions and our living standards.
Science and technology plays a fundamental role in the development paradigm of today's world. The challenges that we face today in the sectors of food and agriculture, clean water, energy, healthcare, environment and climate, security, etc., can be resolved only through effective scientific and technological interventions. The importance of S&T has gained more and more salience in today's knowledge-based societies. While investment in basic sciences is important in its own way, commercialization of research findings is critical to development. Science and technology offers a world of limitless possibilities. New cost-effective sources of energy can alter world's geopolitics. New drug formulations can perhaps delay aging and conquer disease. The Hyperloop can revolutionize the passenger and freight traffic across the globe. Cyberspace can take us all to a completely new world, offering unforeseen opportunities as well as challenges. Yesterday's dream or imagination could be today's scientific reality. As a wise man said, what human mind can conceive and believe in, it can achieve. Today, as I stand before you at the India-Sri Lanka Joint Research Symposium, I see the magic wand that all of you possess. I salute the scientific spirit of inquiry in each one of you. I see in you the potential to transform our collective dreams to reality.
Today, we have inaugurated the Indo-Sri Lanka first ever research program organized by my ministry with the collaboration of Indian counterparts. His Excellency, the High Commissioner of India, he is not a stranger to Sri Lanka. He has been in Sri Lanka some years back, attached to the Indian High Commission. So he is used to our weather conditions, but unfortunately, he is not well today due to some throat issue. And first of all, I take this opportunity to thank the High Commission of India and the Government of India for sending us immediate flood relief to Sri Lanka and affected for more than 500,000 people, especially in five districts, Ratnapura, Kalutara, Gaul, Matara and Hambantota. and some more relief to come within the next couple of days. And just now, I was told by His Excellency, the High Commissioner, as the Minister in charge of Disaster Management, my cabinet colleague, Honorable Appa, has requested India to provide us latest data regarding the weather changes within next couple of days. And then I'm happy to say that High Commissioner confirmed that within couple of hours, by taking all this data and pass it to our the Ministry of Disaster Management to organize the how to tackle the issues risen as a result of weather changes affecting Sri Lanka and even southern part of India. So this is how we should collaborate in the field of science technology. So it's evident, first-hand evident, to show the importance of the collaboration towards science and technology through research. So I must confess that way back in the year 2004, when I was the Minister of Petroleum Industries, I had the opportunity to visit Delhi with then President Madam Chandrika Kumarthunga and the late Foreign Minister Lakshman Kadragama to India to attend one of the international conferences. And there I had the opportunity to visit Shastrapati Bhavan to meet one of the greatest Indian scientists, late Indian President Dr. Abdul Kalam in Delhi. That's the first time I met him. But later, my predecessor, Minister Champaka Ranamaka, invited Dr. Abdul Kalam to Sri Lanka to deliver lecture and engage with some research symposiums in Sri Lanka organized by then the ministry, named in a different way, but the same route. So then I'm happy to say that Dr. Abdul Kalam was in Sri Lanka before his demise to deliver a lecture. So then we got this opportunity as a result of the relationship between Sri Lanka and India prevailed for many centuries. So then it's a new area, science, technology and innovation. So 2 weeks ago, I was in New York attending STI for SDG forum organized by ECOSOC of United Nations at UN headquarters in New York. And there, one of the panelists from India, I can't remember her name, a great scientist from India, she was one of the panelists in a different panel. I was one of the panelists. So then that is how we share the region and internationally the research findings among countries, institutions and the people to address the burning issues that we are facing today and in the future even. We have to face more serious issues as a result of climate change. So I had the opportunity last year to visit one of the regional conferences organized by scientific institutions in Bangalore. I spent 2 days there, a very short period. Even during that period, I had the opportunity to visit the biotechnology park in Bangalore, I think Telangana state. So they have allocated more than 20,000 acres to set up drugs manufacturing factories. In that particular area, I had the opportunity to visit three of the factories. So they are producing the vaccines, then other drugs. I think India, with the population more than 1,200 million, of course, they have their own market. But series of drugs manufactured by those companies exported to the international market and many countries. So even Sri Lanka, we import a series of drugs manufactured by Indian companies. That is how they have improved their biotechnology and then applying to address the health-related issues in India. So those are some experience that they are get, we are getting with our neighboring countries. The My Ministry, the year 2016, the September, the March, we organized STS Forum in Colombo, a 3 days symposium with the participation of more than 700 scientists. Out of 700, more than 100 scientists are from overseas, including some scientists are from India. So then we are going to, we want to organize another symposium, not next year, but not this year, but next year, because we can't afford every year a symposium organized by Japanese STS Forum every year. So then we have been invited by the institution of Japanese to attend that symposium. There again I met some Indian scientists attending regularly to those symposiums. So there's a salient feature that is, of course, the scientists around the world getting together at different forums and different countries and exchange their research findings. My ministry, so now we have a vision that is by 2020 we have to achieve certain objectives. That is, we have to apply the findings of research in relation of nanotechnology, the biotechnology, robotics, artificial intelligence, genomics, and space technology. So just now, His Excellency explained how India has improved the space technology. It's good that because we have one of the institutions under my ministry, that is Arthur C. Clarke Institution of Modern Technologies, responsible for improving and introducing new technologies in space technology. And here we have our first ever nanotechnology laboratory in Homagama. I think His Excellency, Your Excellency can visit to that Slintech. There we have about 25 PhD personnel engaged with research in different areas. So Slintech focusing mainly the nanotechnology developments in the field of the materials that we can find from our country. For an example, the extracting graphene out of graphite, because we are producing the world best graphite, but we export as it is. But if we improve that, so then we can add value some 15,000 times, I was told by some scientists. And then ilmenite you find in the eastern coastal area as well as northwest coastal area. So then still we send ilmenite as it is. So if we add value, so then of course we can earn more foreign exchange as a small country. So those are the areas that we want to collaborate to improve the technologies, especially the emerging technologies that we are not finding it here, but the scientists we have produced, they are serving in other countries. The hundreds of scientists in United States, United Kingdom, Germany, France, Australia, and not in India mostly, because some of those scientists, they had their postgraduate studies in India. Now they are in United States, because I have met them at STS Forum. Then more than 30 Sri Lankan scientists who are in other countries, they came for that STS Forum. Now after that, I am getting down more than 60 now. I have doubled the number of scientists who are working in other countries. So they are ready to come here. And so now, for an example, Professor Tantrigoda is here today with us. He was the chairperson of NASTEC. After his retirement from universities, now he is free to engage with, you know, many scientific research, and he is one of the professors in physics. And then one of his friends, the Professor Tenakon, now he is in, I was told he is in Boston. So he was here, and both of them met me and sent me a note with about 4 pages. But then that is how they told me, though we are a small country, so we have to think big. Otherwise, you can't achieve those goals. Because recently I was in Geneva. So I managed to get 5 professors in physics in different universities of Sri Lanka. Then we went to CERN laboratory. So India is heavily engaged with CERN. They have research collaboration. So we just started. Last year we signed MOU. So this year we managed to send 4 undergraduates from our universities with 2 scholarships, and 2 of them sponsored by National Science Foundation of Sri Lanka under my ministry. So we are sending them. And apart from them, 5 professors engaged with 3 days interaction with the scientists of CERN laboratory. There we met Indian scientists. So they are organizing another regional workshop in Kathmandu within next couple of weeks, and we are sending 3 of our scientists to that conference. And next year, we are ready to sponsor the regional conference in Colombo. So including Indian scientists attached to CERN laboratory and other scientists who are working at different scientific institutions in India. Those are some remarks and remarks that I should mention here today. That is how we concern about research in Sri Lanka with the collaboration of scientists from other countries. So then we have our friends in India, scientists, and then we can further strengthen our bilateral relationship through these 2 institutions, my ministry and the Department of Science and Technology of India. So then I don't take much time of yours today, and tomorrow morning you are starting the reviewing the research whole day on different topics. And then I was told today that for the next year, there are more than 100 of researchers. They want to engage with this research symposium and the program. And then, as mentioned by Professor Vijay Kumar, the president of SLANS, National Academy, SLANS is the different organization, but you are one of the members of SLANS. So then, it's because if this is a research collaboration, of course, as you said, so there must be some kind of a collaboration, not doing research in isolation in India and in Sri Lanka. So we have fundamental research institutions in Kandy. And then apart from that, there are 5 institutions engaged with research out of 12 institutions under the Ministry of Science, Technology and Research. And apart from that, under different ministries, you find, for an example, tea research institution. Then even in India, in Darjeeling area, you have more than the extent of our country, you have tea plantation in Darjeeling. So then we can start some research collaboration with the engagement of tea research institutions, and the coconut research, and the rubber research. So then those are, we have many similarities and then common areas that we can harness. So therefore, mentioning all these, I think you can have a very successful and fruitful symposium tomorrow. And next year, we look forward the support from Science and Technology Department of India and Your Excellency to improve a further relationship between this particular area. So thank you very much for your presence today. It's an encouragement for both the scientists from both countries. So that is why I came here, even with some urgent matters that are related to fund relief. Even, you know, this is my electorate, of course, Kaduela, the most populated single electorate. That we have more than 275,000 population in this particular area, highly dense. And then you find one of the major rivers, the called Kalani, is flowing through Kaduela. So the river banks, the people who are residing on the river banks, of course, affected, and more than 10,000 people now affected, and over 2,000 people are in centers. So then every day we have to supply their meals, and we have to look after them, supplying boats and all that for their transportation, I think. But not as predicted today, we didn't get much rain, I don't know, in the night. But we have to engage with this flood relief, other than the worst affected areas. So once again, I thank His Excellency, the High Commissioner of India, and the Department of Science and Technology of India for helping us to improve the research in Sri Lanka. Thank you very much.